I'm going to talk a bit about causality, and this will be a relatively high level. So rather than telling you details about methods and applications, I just wanted to pitch a couple of ideas. And then maybe we can have a discussion either later today, or also you can follow up on email if you're interested, and we can see whether this has some useful applications. Now, you can also use the chat if you like, just post your question. I'm trying to monitor this a bit as well. I'm going to talk about invariances, causality, and stable prediction. And again, I'll just post a couple of ideas. The two main parts that I'm going to talk about is joint work with Stefan Bauer, Peter Bühlmann, Nikolai Meinshausen, and Niklas Pfister. Now, the first example I'd like to show is a bit a couple of years old now, but I still think it's useful to remind ourselves why we would be interested at all in a causal model. So this is now data from yeast gene expression data, and you have one variable on the y-axis. Let's say this is a response. It doesn't have to be a gene, it can be anything. And now we have a model. So here you see, which is if you plot the data versus another gene, then we see that there's a very strong correlation. And we are very used to these kind of questions of finding predictive models, observational models. And I think the community is getting extremely good in this. And if we are only interested in prediction under observations, this is all what we need to have. However, why would we worry if this is not a causal model? So if the gene is on the x-axis is not a cause of the gene on the y-axis, well, the problem is that even though prediction works well and observational data, it doesn't work well anymore under interventional data. So if you intervene on the gene on the x-axis, then this model that you just fitted may not work very well anymore. And this is what you see here. So indeed, this is a gene that is not causal. And here you see an interventional data point. So where the activity, this is gene deletion actually. So the activity goes down, which is a good thing, right? It's not there anymore. And what you see on the y-axis is that this gene does what it always does. So you don't see any uncausal effect here. So what is the problem? The problem is that our models break down if we intervene on some of the covariates. And now this is sort of a line of research that we looked at into the last years. The question was, can we somehow look or find in the data traces of information that this is actually not a causal model? And we'd like to argue that this answer is indeed yes. So why? Because in this particular data set, you can think about the data consisting of two different sources. So think about an orange data set and a blue data set. And what you see is that indeed, you can already see that for these different sources of data, environments, what we call them, the model is not the same. So the correlation is maybe similar, but the problem is that the variance here, if you fit a linear model, for example, you see that the variance in the orange data seems to be a bit larger than in the blue data. And this is already an indication that you are not looking at a full causal model. And this I would like to explain in a bit more detail, and then we take this idea further. Now, in short, we have a proposal, of course. So rather than just looking at a predictive model in R, you would do just LM for linear model. You can try to do something causal. And here, this is indicated by this term that you see on the bottom. The only additional information that you need to provide is you need an index of an environment. So you say the data really comes from different environments. Now, just to make sure this idea is really based on something that is understood for many decades now in econometrics. It's known under the term of invariance modularity autonomy. That means that if you are intervening somewhere in the system but not on the response, that your model remains the same. And we are actually using this quite a lot also in of course the medical sector. You're saying, well, the treatment itself shouldn't affect how our body responds looks like, but then of course taking into account placebo effects and so on. But if you intervene somewhere, it doesn't affect another mechanism. This is sort of a very old and very well understood principle. Now, what is the underlying idea here? And I would like you to look at the top. So think about having a response variable y, and you have now a couple of covariates. that we denote by x1, x2, x3, x4. And this is now the underlying causal graph that, of course, we don't know. But now something to remember is if you just observe data from this situation and you regress y on all the x's, you actually find that all of them are highly predictive. Only x1 and x4 are causal, which we don't know, but all of them are very predictive because, of course, x2 also carries a lot of information about y. Now, the question is, how can we find out that really x1 and x4 are the causes? And one of this underlying idea is to say, well, if you now observe data, let's say from a different environment, an orange environment, where some of the variables are perturbed, then you can actually use this heterogeneity. And how? So if you perturb somewhere in the system, so in the orange data, somewhere the variables are perturbed, you don't know why or how, it doesn't matter, then the data differs in quite a few aspects. In particular, all the marginal distributions of the variables might be different. A lot of covariances might be different. So the data look very different in the blue and the orange environment, but there's one thing that remains the same, and this is the conditional of y given the causal parents. And this is this old principle. So if you don't intervene on y, if the mechanism of y didn't change, then this must be the same in both environments. And this you can try to exploit, because even though you don't know what the causal structure is, you can just look for these invariances. So this was the start of this line of research. So what do I mean by this? If you, for example, just regress y on x2, it's one model that you could try out, you will find that it's not invariant. How would this look like? So if you plot y on x2, you would find, for example, that you might find two different regression lines. And this is an indication that this is not a causal model. Now, hopefully this is also intuitive, because if you're saying that you understand a certain mechanism, I don't know, I don't work in health, I should say, but let's say in a patient, and you see that if you fit this model to two different patients, you really need different regression coefficients or different noise variances or whatever, then you would probably say, well, okay, but then I didn't fully understand the system yet, right? There seems to be something that I'm missing. And this is all what we are saying. So if you don't find an invariant model, it cannot yet be the causal one. And then, of course, you can now say, well, then I just enumerate all models and I check which of the ones are invariant. And these are good candidates for causal models. So this you can do. So you enumerate all possible models and then you can just check which of the ones are invariant. You also get some guarantees out of this. So for example, I don't want to go into too much details here. If you take the intersection of all these invariant models, you get something that is certainly a subset of a causal of the causal model. Now, what I want to stress here is that the only important thing that we did is we shifted our focus a bit from this prediction aspect, so just look for the best predictive model, to an aspect where we are saying, okay, this invariance over environments, this is actually important. And this brings us closer to causality. So this can be formalized, but I don't need this in the remainder of the talk. The only thing that I need is this principle. Now you can try this out on data as well. And it actually, so this is just this old from 2014 data set. You will find out that if you focus on invariance, then these are the models, or these are the, let's say, potential causal models that you get out. And you see that now these are not necessarily optimal in predictiveness, but you see that in both of these environments, it seems to be possible to fit the same model. This is what we were looking for. So here it looks like, okay, indeed, it could be the same linear model with the same noise variance. And now if you ask, well, are these models causal? Then indeed, at least in these four cases, these are causal as indicated here by the interventional data points. So if you intervene on the x-axis, you also see a change on the y-axis. So this is an indication that there is indeed is a causal relationship. It's not saying that this solves causality. It's just saying that there seems to be a benefit into looking at these invariances and taking them into account. Now, what I would like to do, you can now extend this. We played a bit around with this in the last year. So you can also look at time as an invariant. So you, as an environment, so you're saying, I want to be invariant over time. You can look at nonlinear relations. You can also look at sort of more complicated models with hidden variables. But what I would like to stress now is one other aspect. And this is finding a trade-off between this invariance and predictability. So what do I mean by this? This is my favorite knob. Looks like from an old stereo for listening music. So I just told you that instead of focusing on prediction, if you're interested in these causal models, we should focus on invariance. And now what we did over the last years is to investigate a bit, can you actually find something meaningful if you try to trade off these two terms? Now, here I just want to pitch sort of three ideas of what could be done with it. And then let's see whether there are interesting discussions or thoughts. Idea number one. So this is what we call stabilized regression. What are we doing here? So again, you see, forget about the red arrows for a second. Again, you see a complicated causal graph and a response variable y in the middle. Now we could just regress y on everything else. And then what the variables that appear in our variable selection, so that matter, this is sometimes called a Markov blanket. This is this blue circle here. Before I was arguing, well, we should find a causal model. These are the red ones. These are the parents of Y, because these are the ones where we intervene in the system, the model still holds if you don't intervene on Y directly. But now you could argue, well, if the interventions that you see in the data, if the heterogeneity that you already see, these are indicated by the I variables, if you sort of don't see actually that you don't see all possible interventions, then maybe you think that if I'm using this model for generalization, so to predict in another patient or in another hospital or something, then maybe many things change, but maybe I don't have to find the causal model. So this is too much to ask for. And this is the whole idea. So this green thing in between, this is what we call sometimes call a stable blanket. So this is a model that actually is invariant and predicts very well. Because in this scenario, you will have lots of invariant models. One of them is the causal one, but you will find many invariant models. And now the idea is just to say, well, out of all these invariant models, why should I not just choose the one that is best predictive? So what this leads to is to say, we are sort of having a constraint, if you say. So you're saying, okay, I'm constraining myself to like an invariant model, but now among all these possibilities, I'm looking for the best predictive model. So this is the idea behind stabilized regression. You can sort of then average, you can look at many models and then sort of average, and you start looking at this as a constraint, saying, okay, I'm constraining myself to invariance, and then I'm optimizing for predictability. And what you can now do is you can ask what this GIF and this, I mean, you can analyze this theoretically, but I'm skipping the results here, of course. The hope is that you find models that are actually maybe a bit closer to the causal model. They are not causal, but they are a bit closer and therefore hopefully generalize a bit better. Now, it's a collection of ideas and thoughts, but now one way of thinking about this is to say that this is, you can also think about the regularization. So we are used to think about lasso or rich regression, where we penalize, so where we regularize, let's say large coefficient vectors. But now you can say, well, why large coefficient vectors? I can also try to regularize with this invariance idea. And this is what you can do in anchor regression. I think I skipped the details here, but this is just a form. If you look at this optimization here, if you're familiar with this Lagrangian duality, then this is basically a constraint optimization. So we are looking for minimizing a predictive term subject to a constraint that we want to have an invariant solution. How do we measure invariance here? We are looking at the residuals. This is this y minus xb. And then basically we're looking at something like a covariance with respect to between the residuals and an anchor. Think about this as being the environment that we want to be invariant against. So this very much looks like a rich regression, but now we have a different way of penalizing. Again, you can ask, why on earth would we like to do this? So what is this actually providing us? And there, this is sort of where the theoretical part kicks in that I'm now skipping. You can actually analyze this. And here the answer is that this is optimal under sort of interventions up to a certain strength. So you're saying, well, maybe I'm not interested in being sort of protected against interventions of arbitrary strength, but I just wanted to be protected against certain interventions that are similar to the ones that I already see in the data. Again, the same idea, right? So you would like to find a model that sort of generalizes a bit better to unseen data. And this idea, there's one in the last minutes of the talk. There's one last idea that I wanted to briefly talk about where we actually use this in practice. And this is sort of the third idea. Again, looking at this trade-off, this is something that we call causal kinetics. Briefly introducing the problem. So this is for modeling dynamical systems. So what is a dynamical system? So we are looking at very simple ones generated by mass action kinetics, actually. So here you have the Maillard reaction, an example that is very well understood. So we have a couple of sugars and amino acids, and the parenthesis always means we are looking at the concentration over time. And now this is a differential equation. Now the Maillard reaction, all of you know, this is the picture that I like. This is Raclette. The Maillard reaction is just a chemical reaction that produces this brown stuff close to in cooking and baking. This is the melanoidin. This is what gives the nice flavor. And now, why is this a data science question? The Maillard reaction is very well understood, but in many scenarios, you don't understand the underlying chemical reactions or the network. And now the question is, well, if you just observe data from it, can we somehow infer the underlying structure? And again, we are looking at a scenario where we have one response variable that we are particularly interested in. We are interested in finding, is there sort of, what are the drivers, what are the variables that appear on the right-hand side of this equation? And this is what we looked at a bit. I think it's a surprisingly interesting problem. It's relatively hard. This is often solved with non-linear least squares, which is very slow. And what we just thought is, okay, can we use this invariance idea for regularization here? So we are looking at a real-world system. I can actually show this, where we have one response variable that we're interested in, and we have about 400 covariates. This is a metabolic network, actually, we're looking at, and we have about 400 covariates. So here we cannot, because it's a dynamical system, you cannot just use any arbitrary form from regularization. So you have to be a bit careful of what you're doing, what one is doing here. And we thought, okay, can we use this invariance? So what is the setup? You have data from different environments, let's say green, red, and blue. And again, we are now trying to find a method that does not only yield good predictive performance, but that works similarly well in these green and red and blue environments. And then as before, we are saying among all these potential candidates, we are choosing the ones that are predictive. So among all the invariances. And here, of course, I again skip the details here. This, you can do this, and then you basically get a ranking, and now you have a ranking of models, if you like, of that are both predictive and stable. And the hope is that they generalize better. And this is what you actually also, what we saw in the data as well. And this is, I think, we were quite happy to see this because it again is only, it's only an indication, but it shows that maybe in incorporating these invariants helps. This is maybe just what I show here. This is the last slide, and then I conclude. This is the top ranked model, doesn't say anything, but what I can show you is how it performs on data. And this is, you don't gain anything on in-sample plots. So if you do in-sample prediction, you are as good as many others. But the point is that out-of-sample prediction becomes a bit better. So here, this is the real data where we have five experiments. And the question is, well, if you hold out one experiment, how well can I predict in this last experiment? And what you see here is this green, this is this what we call causal kinetics, and yellow and red are sort of two state-of-the-art competitors. And what you see is that, first of all, it's a very difficult problem. I think it's an interesting problem. So I welcome everyone to look at this. I think it's quite fun also from a statistical point of view. But you also see that it seems seem to gain a bit when generalizing to unseen experiments. And this is similar when you look at variable, sort of variable importance. You also see that if you have a sort of this invariance, if you take this into account, the variable selections you get are a bit more stable. Now, I'm aware of that this was like just a couple of high-level ideas, but let's see. Maybe they still mean something to you. So what is the summary? So invariance can help for causal discovery. That's the main point. And I think, so I can maybe also say it, I've worked on this for a couple of years. I think it's an interesting topic. And I do think that this is usually this invariance idea in many of the real-world problems that we looked at. They seem to be sort of a bit more reliable than other ideas that we looked at least. And then this trading of invariance and predictability, I think this is still sort of, they are only first steps, but the three ideas that I just very briefly talked about was the stabilized regression, saying among all the invariant models, just we average over the ones that are very good in predictability. Anchor regression, this idea of having a penalization term that instead of just looking at an L2 norm, that looks at an invariance term. And then this in a bit more complex systems like this dynamical systems, you can actually also exploit these ideas. So they are not bound to any linear models or something, but they seem to be a bit more general, always relying on the fact that you have this heterogeneity in the data that you can exploit. Something we are also now working on at the moment, there's a strong link to linearity. But we can talk offline if you happen to be interested. These are just a couple of the references. Now with this, many thanks for your attention. I think I started a bit late. I'm still, now it's 27. You can just tell me whether we should discuss a couple of the questions or just.
Yeah, no, thanks. Thanks, Jonas. You actually really stayed in time. Thanks so much for this very inspiring talk. You know, starting with really simple principles, but then also outlining how they can be extended further. Lots of potential interest. We have time for a few questions. Let's be fast, quick questions and quick answers to get some through. One of them is from Vitaly. He asks whether, you know, the notion of environment, where does environment end and start? You know, for example, changes of the causal mechanisms across environments is obviously a limiting factor. So your take on the definition of E, the environment.
Very good point. So two short answers. One is whenever the environment is something that is upstream of the response, then you are safe to use it. We use something like continent, you can use something like time. Whenever you're not directly intervening on why, you can, you're safe to use it. One more thing is that I'm working a bit with people in Earth system science, and they are always saying, well, you never have all the variables that are important. You never observe them. And then you have switching environments because there's one factor that you don't observe. And there you can still do something, but it becomes a bit more tricky, but this is what we exploited a bit, because in some scenarios, you actually know that the true mechanism is not invariant because you are missing an important factor, and then you can try to account for that.
Mm-hmm. A linked question to the question, what is an environment, from Ali Reza, mentioning work on electronic health records, where there's one question, you know, could we use different people as environments? I mean, it's also a question, you know, does environment need to be an external variable? It could be sort of identical biological systems, common replicates, essentially, right? I mean,
I think so, yes. So one can, of course, so now there's a trade-off. We need to have more than one data point in an environment. But if you have repeated measurements over patients, this is something that I actually discussed with one of our postdocs, Sebastian Weichwald, quite a bit, who worked in brain-computer interfaces. Because what does it actually mean if we find these mechanisms that are not invariant over patients? What did we learn? Or on the other hand, I can also turn this around. If you find something that is invariant over patients, even if it's not causal, I would claim it's already interesting. And one last thing maybe regarding these environments, if the environment is misspecified, you usually, this is of course a problem, but it's not such a big problem, because usually this, you can realize this, because if the environments are misspecified, so for example, it acts directly on the response, then you find that just, you don't find any invariant model. So there's a bit of a self-correcting mechanism in there.
That's interesting, yeah. Question from Britta Welton, asking, you know, that environment may change or affect the response variable itself, and thereby, for example, structures.
Mm-hmm, thanks. I mean, this is probably what I was referring to before. So if it affects the response variable, again, so the first point is if it affects the response variable, you're really realizing this because you don't find anything that is invariant. Now, the question is, you can try to incorporate this knowledge and just fit more complicated models. If the environment acts on the response variable in an arbitrarily complex way, you cannot do anything, at least not with this framework. Well, not that we know of. But if the influence is simple, for example, it acts on a different time scale than the causes that you're looking for, or it is just binary, this is what we looked at, then you can still try to account for this by just fitting these models. I mean, Oliver is probably much better in this in fitting these models than I am, because if you know a bit about these latent variable models and so on, and if you have smoothness assumptions like Gaussian processes and so on, you can try to take this into account.
Okay, and the very last question, very simple, but obviously very impactful, from Ulrich Köthe, how to handle nonlinear mechanisms?
Yeah, so this is one way of looking at this, and people who work with graphical models prefer this view. I'm undecided, I like either way. So if you think about this invariance principle, it really says that the conditional of y given x, this should be invariant, right? So this means y given x should be independent of e. So this is a conditional independent statement. So the environment should be independent of y given x. So one way is to say you go for conditional independence testing. This is a hard problem. Instead, what you can do is you can just fit nonlinear models and just check whether they're invariant over environments. And this is usually a bit more powerful than using non-parametric conditional independence tests, because you can specify for what kind of non-invariances am I looking for,